Hi, I'm Paul Marcel. So every so often I get an email or a request asking for a shop tour. I'm thinking, well, with all the projects, you get an angle of about everything in here, so no real reason to get a shop tour. Plus, I don't really like show and tell, and I'm really bad at it.
I have a drill press. I have an anvil.
As you can see. So after replying to the last request, I got back a reply that said that, well, the thing is that during my project build videos, he spends time looking in the background, like we all do, trying to get ideas from other people's shops, and he had a couple questions about some of the things going on in here. So I thought, that I could do. So that's what this video is. It's going to have a bunch of little tiny clips pointing out different things in my shop, things that I think worked well for me, and pointing out a couple things that I thought would work well for me and didn't work well. So hopefully there's some ideas in here for you to poach. So let's go. So the space below the table on the drill press table is a total waste normally because there's just a column and then a flat foot. So what I did is I made this small cabinet down here that has two sustainers. In my case, what I like is this drawer here. These are all the small planes that I like to use fairly often, but they don't really fit well underneath the table where I have all my other ones. So this worked out really well. Now on the side, since the vise is here and this is where I used to do all the dovetails, I have the three saws from Veritas. They're just on a board that's mounted to it, has a kerf at an angle so that they just hold them there. And then down here, I made basically fingers that hold these Japanese saws since I like using these for sawing as well. So it's a good way of hanging them up. I find I don't like these on a magnetic thing just because it's such a flexible blade that you kind of got to argue with it to get it off. And on the other side, I have three little shelves that hold two other planes that I have that are more specialty planes. Now, if I ever needed to lower this table, which actually, since I've put it here, I haven't needed to, this table moves very easily. It's not attached, it's just sitting here. So you can just take out the two sustainers and pretty much give it a lug and it'll be right out. So swinging around behind the table, I have a number of chargers mounted to it, so it makes it really convenient. Now they're all connected to this sort of wall of plugs that I created back here. Now the ones that have a black cover are all attached to the timer that's in the middle here. So when I go to charge up a battery, I just flip the timer on, give it an hour of time on there, then it shuts off. Now on top of the drill press, I have this table that I built. What I didn't like is this Powermatic drill press has this kind of curvy, it almost looks like alien top. So you can't store anything up there. And this is a perfect place for putting drill bits and all. So what I did is there are three holes in the plastic, two in the front, one in the back. And all it is, it's a recess that goes down about this far. And then there's a screw in the bottom that then attaches it to the drill. So all I did is I took some dowels, so I just thinned them with a tenon maker that you use for timber, and made it the right size that this thing goes into the hole with very little slop and sits on top of the screw. So it's not pressing on the plastic. That's the key. And then I just made this tabletop. So it's really nice that this just sits in there. So it's easy to just drop it in. So it's pretty easy to take out as well, but it's very stable. So up here I keep the drill index, a couple of the hand drills, and actually all the batteries, since the battery chargers are right down there, I keep all the spare batteries up in the back there after they've been charged. So this really works out well for a station and kind of gets it out of the way. I'm down here. So I like using these hooks up in the ceiling for hanging silly things. Above my drill press table, I have these Craig clamps that I use, little push-down clamps. So it's nice to hang those up there. These things don't fit anywhere, but they hang up here perfect. Get it out of the way. Over here, I have another strip of wood that goes between two of the ceiling joists. So there's a screw on either end, so it's got a lot of good strength. And then I have these same big hooks. They're dirt cheap when you go to Harbor Freight. But they have these big wide hooks. So what I did is I hung all the extra Festool hoses up there. Now, just because they look like they'd be awkward to get at, actually, they're stiff enough that if you grab the hose, you can pretty much just pull it right off and put it right back on with no problem. So it's like anaconda management. And I'm sure you already know about the drill press table. So I put all my stuff on here because it's a horizontal surface, but when I needed to use the drill, just carry it away. Now over here is a small wall of sortainers. Now granted, for me, the top half of this is all for camera stuff, whether it's cables, batteries, little filters, and things like that that are I was constantly losing. Now at least they're all in here and easy to get at. The bottom half are mostly smaller tools like marquetry inlay tools, that are also kind of awkward to store. So this works out really well. It doesn't have to be Sortainers that you use. You can also go to a place like the Borg. You'll find that they have a lot of different interlocking containers that might have small compartments. Now this bottom cabinet that's down here also has three Sustainers on them. Now this one is also on slides. Basically, if it had a Sustainer on it, I always put slides on it. Almost everything in here is on slides. Just adding that to parts of your shop, you'll find things are a lot nicer. Now this little cabinet has a bit of a story that might be useful for you. Originally, I had a benchtop drill press before I got this bigger one. This used to be where this stand is, and when I put the benchtop drill press, it was possible for me to make it planar to this bench. So it was really easy to lower it down and still have all the quill travel that I needed to be able to work on whatever and still have things sit both on the table and on the bench simultaneously. Prior to that, the drill press was kind of on the ground and I'd just lug it up onto the bench, do something, and lug it back down. So that just made it so much more convenient and I got storage out of it. Now this cabinet back here is something that you can get at Costco. It's awesome for having all these little containers in it for the different size storage. I find it great for things like home construction. I have a bunch of caulk containers down here. They all fit perfectly in here. You have, you know, electrical bin, plumbing bin, all that. All these are the goofiest things to store, and it's so nice to be able to just pop them in here. Only thing you have to do, take a piece of scrap and tuck it in underneath here, because this part here will sag down until it hits there, so you get a little bit of a slope. If you just put a piece of scrap wood under there, perfect. Now this cabinet's attached to the wall, but there were a couple measurements that I kept in mind when I was building it. For one, I tried to plan on having at least a Sys1 and a Sys2 together in the lower drawers, and then the top one, they could actually get a little bit taller, so these were all planned. These, like everything else, are on slides, so it makes it really nice for some of the oddball ones, like this one here, that has a little bin in there, because I have a number of things in different places, so it's easy to pull it out and take things out from the back. Otherwise, the back just becomes a junk drawer. So same thing here with all the sharpening tools. I have some diamond pads back here as well as like some of the oils and such. But one of the key things is that I use a lot of these bins, these plastic bins. You can get them at Costco. You can get them about anywhere. But I made sure that the top of this was going to be give me about an inch clearance underneath there, so I could always tuck a bunch of these on the top. That gives me a lot more room and a lot better storage. So a lot of these things are some simple, like there's some specialty clamps in this. There's some dust collector fittings in these far ones. They're things that I don't use all that often, so it's nice to store them up but not have them too far away. And you can also see the same idea over on the finishing cabinet up there. The two green bins are larger ones that I had, so I simply made sure the cabinet went as tall as it could and still left room for those to fit in up there. So if you plan on using the tops, try not to make it something where you just push things up for storage, because you're never going to go up there and really get anything beyond what's right up front. At least I don't. Okay, so everyone's got a junk corner, and this is mine right here. Actually, all these are boxes of things that I'm keeping in order to finish the videos for No Comment number 2. So once I get those videos done, then these kind of props can finally get thrown away. But what I brought you here for is to show you the finished cabinet. Now these drawers are all on slides, so it's nice to have these drawers that come all the way out like that. So these are 6 square feet of useful shelf each. So, and it's nice that I can easily reach back there and get things. Now granted, on the top one it's a little bit more difficult, but if you plan the way you stack things up, it actually becomes pretty easy. Certainly in the middle of a top shelf like that, that's where you can put those big gallon containers of naphtha, alcohol, anything like that, because you're easily going to be able to see it. So all of these are like that. Now the reason why this doesn't tip over is because there's a bracing member in the back and it's attached to the wall. So now you see that my water heater is kind of constrained back there. Once I had a problem with it, it took me a total of, you know, with a panic of water, you move faster. It took me 15 minutes to empty that, because each of these drawers, you know, you can yank it out and you can release the latches and carry the whole tray over and put it down somewhere. I'm not going to say it's the easiest thing, but when you got water running, you move fast. Now the spacing on all these drawers, the bottom two there, this one here and this one here, are made so that you can use these green crates. So you can put green crates on any of these, they'll fit. I mostly use that for the ones on the bottom. There they have, that's where I keep extra containers. Now you'll notice that all my finishes, after they're taken out of a can, they end up going in these canning jars. What I like a lot about these is that, for one thing, they're really good glass, but second, the lids are two-part. So what's nice about it is if the seal gets really gunked up. You buy these seals in a separate box, so you get 10 of them for next to nothing. And you can easily just peel that off, clean whatever you need to off the jar, and then you can reuse the ring. So I really like that about these jars. Now, the sizes go all the way from half pints all the way up to quarts, so it works out really well that you can kind of bring it down as you use up your stock. So much like I planned the height and placement of the other cabinets so that I had room for bins on the top, when I made this shelf here to kind of run down this length, I planned them with these green crates in mind. So what's nice about the green crates, of course, they hold about any old random thing. So in here are all my painting supplies, rollers and such. But what's nice is it acts like a little bit like a drawer, very easy to pull out. And because they're perforated, I can kind of tell what's in them. So I usually don't spend much time searching. I pretty much can pull it out. So the dust extractor has a couple interesting things on it. For one, the WCR-1000, this contraption that sits up here. Now, mine is an older CT-22 vac. This is actually made for the newer models, the 26 on up. So for those, it would attach directly. But I actually don't mind the way that this worked out, because what I did is originally when I had this vac, I had a large sustainer down here, and then I made a box that frames it and just sits on the top. So it slides down and makes a friction fit. And what was on top of that box was a piece of cork like I have here. The reason why is that way there I could use the saw or whatever and I could reach around and put it down on the cork. It wasn't going to move anywhere, and if it was the sander and it was kind of buzzing around a little bit, that would dampen the motion. So I really like that, because then when I put the tool on here, you know, the hose is going to the tool. This whole thing is one unit. I don't have to worry about turning around and walking into the hose. Now, since then, I've swapped out the sustainer and I put a sortainer. So it's nice to have the things like pliers and cutters and some of the other accessories, some of the chucks that go with the drills that are up here. So it makes it that this is much more useful for where I'm at. So when I got the WCR, all I did is I screwed it into this little top that I had previously. And then I added a small piece of ply with the cork on there so it could act as that landing pad that I was so used to. Now with that wood, of course, that we've got on here, you can do a lot of useful things. You can put a little tiny hook back here, so I keep an extra loose cable back there. And the other thing we've got on the wood is I just put a magnetic strip here, so then I keep a couple of these simple little double squares. These just come in really handy wherever you're at. Take some quick measurements and hold a couple. Now up here on the boom arm, I have a little hook that I made. So what this is for holding the hose up out of the way. What it is I went to the store and you pick up one of these special hooks that they make for drills. This is for on a pegboard. So this would go in normally into a pegboard, and then it holds a T-shaped drill. So I just held it up to the pipe and then I took some ties. I put two ties, one tie here and one tie there, to basically hold it against the pipe. And then I have two additional ties that grab this hook and squeeze it against the pipe, so that keeps it from wanting to rotate. I thought it was going to be hokey and it would eventually rotate, but it's been there for 4 or 5 years now. It has never done that. So it's really easy to put up there. And what I like about it is you can pretty much just throw it right up there very easily. Now over on the saw stop, you've seen a little tour of it before, so you know how the whole dust collection thing works and the arm can tip down. There is a really bad video for that one. I tried a new lighting technique that did not work. But one of the things that's nice about this is that besides the dust box that I put here for the router table that I put into the extra wing, is that I've also added some shelves here that were against it. So between the shelves and the dust box, there's room for the extra blades that go there, or the different types of blades, as well as the extra throat plates for the different dados or different types of blades, magnetic featherboard, and a square for setting the blade, because lately I'm beveling everything. Now I just store the magnets right underneath here. I kept losing the stupid things, and I thought, well, why don't I just put them right here? They're hidden and out of the way. Now one other trick, especially because I bevel quite a bit, is when you have a zero clearance insert on there, of course it's perfect for 90 degrees, so as soon as you start cranking on the bevel, you're sitting there putting a lot of stress on the side of the blade till you realize that you forgot to switch out the throat plate. So what I did is on this wheel down here, which is the bevel angle wheel, is I hang the correct throat plate that I need to use. So if I go to reach back there and grab the handle, I'm grabbing this instead. So it reminds me to swap it out, and I know it's reminded me several times. Now there are a couple things that are hiding back here. For one, the water softener and the filter for the house. Now I put those back there because when I was building a large cabinet, I was getting very concerned as I was moving around the parts that I might swipe and hit one of the bottles and break it. So I built this and then I finished the cabinet. But it actually has some great use. On the side here, I've mounted a board where I put a number of hangers so I can easily hang all the guide rails. So this is great for hanging a lot of the shorter guide rails. And of course, there's a horizontal surface on the top ready to go to put some other things on. Now over here, there's the reservoir for the salt, for the softener. So because you can't really get too close to it anyway, I built this shelf that comes off over it. Now, what's interesting about the shelf is at the top part of it here, I mortised a bunch of domino holes in it. So these things here that are hung on there, like this spray gun rack, there's just a domino sticking up because on the underside of here, I put domino holes in the correct place. So I can basically hang it anywhere I want along that shelf. So this is a stand holder for the HVLP gun that I used to use before the Fuji, and I still use for shellac. Now these other curious things were because that big long cabinet had 12 shelves in them. So while those were being finished, I needed a place to hang them. So I created this silly thing. So there's a pair of nails here and a nail up here, so that when you put the shelf in there, they'll just cantilever off to the side and they don't really leave too much of a dimple on it when you're doing the finishing. But where do these go? Well, they're hung on there by a domino because there's domino mortises here, but I also put three dominoes on the top of this cabinet. So if I want, I can hang this one on this side and then hang the other one over here for the long shelves. So for the long shelves that I was making, this was perfect. Then I also made it with one that's a little bit offset here. So if I wanted to do some shorter shelves, which I actually ended up doing on a subsequent cabinet, I can just scoot that over and now I have racks for those. And it's easy to take it apart. So that's actually worked out to be kind of a good idea, and I've used these little hangers up here for different holders sometimes. So with the router table being here in the extension wing of the saw stop, I went ahead and added two additional shelves that have all the router table, feather boards, the insert rings, and then a coping sled up there. So it keeps it all kind of, when I'm here, everything for the router table is here. Now I use a lot of those green crates that you saw before. I use them down here for my offcuts that go underneath the table. And I just have them sitting on these furniture movers that you can get for next to nothing at Harbor Freight. So every now and then those come on sale and I'll grab a couple. So each one of these bins is on one. So as I do a project, just kind of toss them underneath there. I do have to get better about managing that. Now, as an extension to that, when I was doing the veneering of the panels, I created a version of that with just some wheels that has the VacuPress pump on it. So it's a custom cart that just has some roller wheels on the bottom. These were actually some scrap from a previous shop project I did. And then this shelf comes off the top, so it's easy to get at the pump to remove it if you needed to. And at the same time, it makes it good that I can put all the fittings that I normally use with it up here on the top. It's again one of those awkward to store things. Now the other reason why it's nice to have here is I was tinkering with some vacuum clamping options for the MFT, so it turned out this would have been a great place to store it, but those never really ended up panning out. Now, prior to this bandsaw, I had a Rycon 14-inch deluxe bandsaw. Now, due to the way that they poured the concrete here, because there's a step, it turns out that right this here in this location, it's really uneven. So, and I also wanted my bandsaw tilted like this, so it's not square to the edge. So what I did is I created a small torsion box. So I took some 2x4s to make a webbing, and then I put exterior ply on the top and bottom skins, and the inside had been filled with some quick-set concrete that I had left over anyway. So it made for a nice heavy base, and I bolted the Rycon down to that, and then I was able to shim that to make it level. Now the thickness of the torsion box base was set such that the table for the Rycon was just a hair higher than this shelf. Now this pre-existed, along with all the junk on it, the Rycon bandsaw. So by increasing that, I was able to make it just a hair higher than this, which was nice because if I needed that extra couple feet, all I had to do was, you know, move the food processor or whatever was there at the time, and then I could push it all the way back, plus I could let the board sit on the other end. So it acted a little bit as an infeed support. So while I can't do that with this saw because it's so much lower than this shelf, it turns out it was a pretty nice idea and I really liked it. So that might be something that works out for you. So you've seen this bench 100 times, but there are probably some details that you haven't seen yet. All of these sustainers are on drawers, so I have them all on slides. They come out nicely. One of the things that I did is to make it that I can just push the sustainer, is I used a little domino back here that catches in the little slot that we have here in the back of the sustainer. So it makes it nice that it holds it in the right position and I can push on the front and it closes it nicely. Now the other thing I did, and this is mostly for the classic sustainers, is I made it that the latches are always on the opposite side of me, because these are kind of hard to open if you've ever noticed. It's a little bit easier when you have them away from you, because you can just flick it with your thumb. So it makes it a lot easier than pulling it with your finger. At least I find so. It's a minor thing, but it's one thing I really like. So one of the things I have up here, this one here is my domino assortment. So when I'm doing work, it's easy to just pull out some dominoes for dry fit or whatever I'm doing. One of the other real useful ones I have, now this one is a 12-drawer sortainer. So in here I have, you know, a screw collection. It has a whole bunch of different size screws in it. It's really nice when you're at the bench that you have that assortment right there. Now on top of it is this kind of goofy contraption. What this is it's a utensil organizer like you would get at a store. I bought this because I was sizing some drawers for a refinishing I'm doing in my house. And I had it just sitting out here and I thought, I'll try it. So all I had to do was I stuck a small block of wood underneath here. So this way here I can have it kind of hook onto the back and hook onto the front, and it stays in place while I go to open and close the drawer. But it's really nice for having some of these odds and ends that you don't know what to do with, like some chamfering tools, hole punches, a block of wax, and then a bunch of sort of dry fit dominoes. Some of these have been sanded, so they're easier to do dry fit. So it becomes the junk drawer, but it's nice that it's right here. And lastly, on the front parts, we have two drawers over here. So when I was laying out where the sustainers can go and all that at the time, I didn't have as many. These things multiply. So I just put two extra drawers. One of them is for holding the chisels up top, and the other one has more of the marking and layout tools. So that's just kind of handy to have those here too. The only bad part is because their holes are perforated up here. These are all 20 millimeter holes like they have on the MFT, so I can reuse all the same jigs and clamping elements on here. But of course, that means all the junk falls in there. So these drawers here are always dirty. Now, one thing that was a failed idea with this is because these sustainers only go so far into the drawer, there's a whole bunch of dead space back here. So what I did at the time is I made a hole back here. So it's easy for me to remove this. I have a whole bunch of clamps back here. So these are all my longer ones that I don't use very often, because what I found is in practice, this clamp hole that's back here, well, it never really works for me, because invariably, when this is all closed up, I have something on top of it. So when I need some clamps, I have to rearrange the whole bench to get to the clamps. So that didn't really work. So right now I just have some of the lesser used clamps hiding back there. So there's a hole here and then a hole back there, which you can see how useful that one would be. Now above the bench is where I decide to put my clamps. A lot of people will put clamps where they store them straight in and they go all the way across the wall. It's exactly what I did when I first started, and I realized that it took a lot of wall space. So I ended up creating two triangles that come off the wall and they just hook right on here. Now I did have to, after I did the triangles, I added an extra board here, because without it, if I put this near the front, you'll be able to see it, it would tend to hang like this. So with that board there, it just kept it so it'll hang down nice and straight. But what's nice about this is previously I had a very long one that held about 10 clamps. And right up here right now I have 10 clamps as well, but they take a whole lot less room. And it's actually kind of nice because you can grab two at a time very easily while you're doing a clamp up, holding something in place because you forgot to take the clamps down. Since all this is just hollow drywall, I put a number of boards here that they go into different studs that are behind the wall. So at least this way here, it gives me more mounting space without having to completely destroy the wall. But what was really nice is putting these hooks for tape. I don't know, I go through a lot of tape when I'm doing about anything, so it's nice that they're right there. Now along those lines, I've talked about this before on my blog, I use this tape dispenser constantly. It's really super useful to have. In fact, I think I use more tape now because it's so easy to dispense. Now down here between the benches, there's actually a lot going on. Now these benches are actually planar, so I can put a board on here straight across this gap and pretty much it's flat going across. But what's nice about this, I always like using my jigsaw here because then all the chips fall down in the garbage can. So this was a mistake at first. I didn't have everything placed correctly, but now I like it so much I'd make sure I do it again. Now the side of the MFT, I put a board here that has a number of different holders, so it makes it easy to put things like the combo square, keeping them kind of off to the side, but conveniently placed. And also they're below this gap, so they're never really in the way there. And I also have like an air gun down here, so there's a nail gun. Normally I have a canister of CO2 down there as well, so if you're doing some nailing, it's pretty easy to do. I found I don't use the nail gun very often. I use it mostly when I'm doing things in the house, but it was kind of convenient to have here. Now on this other side, where you're not going to be able to see from that angle, I do have a large square, a 24-inch square, so that just sits on a simple rack onto the corner, And also, since I have a computer in here, I do have two wireless devices here. So I keep a Bluetooth keyboard and a trackpad down here. Now, it's a Windows box, but I use these Apple ones because they're all aluminum, so they're pretty durable. Work well for Bluetooth. Really light, really small. It's just leaning up against the side, which is nice that the dust doesn't land in any of the keys, but at the same time, it's really handy to get at. So the last shop organization tip is to have a good place for your manuals. Now, back here, I have all these plastic containers. What these are is they're about A4 size, so you can easily fit some 8.5 by 11 manuals. And then I also have some of a smaller size that would fit smaller manuals. Now, what's nice about these is these manuals here, like these little Festool ones, they're all a couple different sizes. There's the small format, and then there's some larger format manuals. And then like the SawStop manual is a ring binder, but then there are a number of other things that I have for the SawStop that are also in this red tabbed one. So it makes it really easy that I can easily organize my manuals this way here. But then all those oddball things where a manual is just a printout with a staple, or some of them are ring bound, some of them are really bound properly, they all end up fitting in one of these boxes. They're easy to move around, easy to search through, and if I come in here with the air and I blow out all the dust, I don't have to worry about the manuals flying everywhere. So there you go. I hope something in here is useful for you. If you have some other tips and suggestions or improvements to some of the ideas, feel free to leave that in the notes. That'll be great for everybody. Thank you.